Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to church this morning. There was a nice group here yesterday welcoming everybody to church this morning, so it looks a whole lot different. Before you leave, just look out here and look how nice everything looks. The clean concrete, the clean area up here, all the work with the new plants and everything else. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. So everybody that was here, there must have been a dozen. Did anybody count? Is that a pretty close number? Yeah. And everybody worked hard for at least the whole morning into the afternoon. So thank you so much. Offering envelopes are back there. Finally, the manufacturer found a way to get them to South Florida. So they're here. Please take yours and start to use them. There's a Smiles event 2 days from today. I don't know what the program is. Bible study on the 1st of March. And this, please note that the time changes the first Sunday in March for the service time. It goes to 10 o'clock. So I think that Sunday is the 6th or something like that. But it's a Sunday after Ash Wednesday. Oh, and by the way, I've got pretty much the schedule for Ash Wednesday, Lent, Holy Week, and Easter pretty well worked out, and I'll be sending it to everybody, or at least I'll send it to Josie and to social media so that they can all put it everywhere that people can see it. So please kind of plan to participate if you would please. Those are kind of very traditional and very welcoming and very meaningful services for us as we just kind of remember the last days of Christ. Okay. Our first hymn is, and I think I had a note on that one, All Creatures Worship God Most High, and we will sing only verses 1, 2, and 3, and please rise as we sing.
Oh,
love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord Jesus, make us instruments of your peace, that where there is hatred, we may sow love, where there is injury, pardon, and where there is despair, hope. Grant, O Divine Master, that we may seek to console, to understand, and to love your name, for you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We thank St. Francis for granting that prayer.
Please be seated.
A reading from Genesis, the 41st chapter. Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Is my father still alive? But his brothers could not answer him. So dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, come closer to me. And they came closer. He said, I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourself, because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth, and to keep alive with you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh, and lord to all his house, and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you here, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them. And after that, his brothers talked to him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading, the reading from the 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? What kind of body do they come? For what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And as for what you sow, you do not sow the body that is to be, but a bare seed, perhaps of wheat or some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body. So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a physical body, and it is raised as a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is a spiritual body. Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the physical and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so are those who are of dust. As is the man of heaven, so are those who are of heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we will also bear the image of the man of heaven. What I am saying, brothers and sisters, is this. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Aleluya.
lesson. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you. And if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even the sinners do the same. If you lend to those from whom you hope to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend the sinners to receive as much again. But love your enemies, do good, and lend, expecting nothing in return. Your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap. For the measure you give will be the measure that you get back. Hope's the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Sonny, I think it's me and you.
Can you remember what we celebrated this past week on Monday? Remember Mondays or Sunday and Monday? You know, Tuesday, you know all this. Monday we had a special day. Remember what it was? Spaghetti's on Saturday. Mm-hmm. You know what this is from? What day would it be given to everybody?
Valentine's Day. Yes, it was. We had Valentine's Day on Monday.
And did you get some nice things for Valentine's Day? Did you get?
Yeah.
Did you get candy?
Yeah.
Did you get lots of it? Did you get Grandpa any?
No.
Did you get some nice cards from your friends at school? You got stickers, okay. And you give them stickers too? Mm-hmm. And what did your daddy give to your mom?
Flower.
And what did grandpa give to your grandma?
Car.
A car, this is the card I gave to grandma. And what else did I give? That I gave to all of you ladies. What's that thing that was on the table? Yes. What color were they?
Red.
Red. Yes. Everything is red. And red, you know what red, when we give red on Valentine's Day? Red is, chocolate starts red in general. Red is the color of love. You know what love is? Hmm? If I say, Sonny, I love you, is that all right to say?
No.
Nah? Who says I love you? You. Nobody? Did your puppy say I love you? And lick on your leg like that? No? Anyway, what we're talking about today is love.
Lord, help us to love each other in our lives. And help us to say that all the time. Okay? All the time.
Yes.
I think he's got you. He wants to talk about love. Okay? Can you help me up in the good Sunday school?
Oh, wait a minute. Let me get myself propped up here first. Okay. Ready, set, go. Oh, thank you.
You were real talkative this morning. That's unusual. Let's start out with a little story. I think Bubba will attest to this, and anybody else that works with little kids will attest to this. But I think this is a story that happens just about every day, or at least once a week on every elementary school playground. And say, for example, two fourth graders get into it at recess. Something about, he did this, and so I did that, and it goes back and forth and back and forth from there, and somebody gets hurt, and somebody else gets hurt worse, and it just escalates. And then there's no telling even if this will ever end, okay? These little kids get into these scraps. Well, it's not only the little kids. But does that sound familiar? Bubba, doesn't that happen to you a little bit over there at that Air Base Elementary? I bet you it does. I think we've all experienced this pettiness, and then we also say to ourselves, you know, that's really kind of silly, isn't it? But I would suggest to you that we can kind of remove the names from the kids, Billy and Joey, from the little elementary kids, and put in words like husband and wife, and the story is pretty much the same. Or we can insert the names of two school rivalries. Story's pretty much the same. Two rival companies, or like the Hatfields and the McCoys. Now we got the Republicans and the Democrats doing the same thing. The pro-lifers and the pro-choicers are going at it. Israel and Palestine are still going at it. America and about any country in the Palestine. You can name it, Israel and Palestine and every place else. Now we have the governor's office going on with the Archbishop of the Catholic Church here in Miami. And by the way, I stand right behind Archbishop Wenske, okay? He's my man, and I agree 100% on that. But conflict at any level, folks, is conflict. If it's not preventable, most conflicts is at least resolvable, okay? But not until one side at least refuses to retaliate and instead decides to reconcile. Reconcile, it's kind of a key word for today. If I were to ask you your philosophy on life, could you tell me what your philosophy of life is all about? I would think most of us don't think about our life philosophies very much. Or rather, let's say call it the set of beliefs that drives our worldview or what we think. Our philosophy of life comes out of us in a pretty subtle ways, generally. It's the attitude with which we wake up in the morning. It's how we treat other people. It's how we approach a brand new situation. Things we spend our time and energy and money on. It's a lot of things. And I think it's worth taking a little bit of time to examine our life philosophy, because in many ways it creates our life story. Let's think about it kind of like this. It's kind of like a GPS for our life. I think by now just about everybody understands GPS, global positioning systems, okay? Maybe you have it in your car. Maybe you have it on your phone. Well, I know you probably have it on your phone, because even if you don't know it, people can tell where you are at any moment if you have your phone. Okay. Well, you program your destination, for example, into your car, and it push the button and it takes you to where you need to go and it shows you the exact routes that you should take. Hey, I had a friend one time, and I think this is not a totally true story. He said he was had this on in his car, and he kept turning the wrong way, and the GPS lady kept going, "Turn around, stupid." probably apocryphal. But it's supposed to help you give direction to where you need to go. But of course, it does not work all the time, okay? I read about three ladies who escaped after their GPS thing in their rental Mercedes and took them right into a lake. And I suspect you've heard about all of them too, but be careful out there, folks, because even those car GPSs sometimes aren't as good as people think they are. And I go back to say this, that many people live lives that lack direction. With a reliable philosophy of life, I think we can program our life with a set of beliefs. We can set with a whole set of values or a set of priorities that will guide us to where we want to go. The best source of that philosophy, in my opinion, is Jesus. Just listen to his word, read the, especially the New Testament, and you will see and hear what he says, and that's where I want to go this morning. He is the word of God that comes to us from heaven. He is God's revelation in the way our lives should be lived. You see, Jesus' entire philosophy of life was based on love. And this is an important truth that I don't think we simply cannot miss. We should not miss it. When you base your life on love, 99% of your decisions are already made. Let me say that again. When you base your life on love, 99% of your decisions in life are already made. In our gospel that I just read here a few minutes ago, Jesus was introducing the disciples to a whole brand new way of life. And this is how things work in the kingdom of God, Jesus was saying to them. You see, Jesus' entire philosophy of life was rooted in love. I'm constantly amazed how many times Christians miss that truth. But there's a reason for that. Maybe we've never really listened to the teachings of Jesus. Notice how Jesus begins that gospel read, okay? Starts out by saying this, "But to you who listen," or "to you who are listening, love your enemies." That's interesting. To you who listen. It's not, "Hey, all you guys, listen up, listen up." It's to you who are listening. You know, I shouldn't probably say this because this probably isn't true here this morning. Some people come to church on Sunday morning and sit and turn off their minds. They're tired, distracted, they're angry, or not even sure even why they're here. And for whatever reason, they're not ready to listen to the gospel, because listening means opening to learning something new. Listening means we're open to change. Listening to God means being obedient to God. That's a word we don't kind of like too often. Obedience. Obedience. Jesus knew that only a few people may really listen to his message. He knew most people weren't ready to have their life philosophy turned upside down. But to those who are listening, he offers a philosophy of life that provides not only hope, but it provides salvation as well. Listen to that again. In its entirety. He says, "But to you who are listening, I say, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. If someone slaps you on one cheek, turn to them and the other also. If someone takes your coat, do not go without your, take your shirt from them off either. Give them your shirt. Give to everyone who asks. And if anyone takes what belongs to you, do not demand it back. Do to others as you would have them do to you. Then he asked a couple of kind of interesting, powerful questions. He said, if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Think about that. Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who are good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do that. And if you lend to those from whom you expect repayment, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners, expecting to be repaid in full, probably with interest. But love your enemies. Do good to them and lend them to them without expecting to get anything back whatsoever. Then your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, because He is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Then the last part. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. You know, what an amazing passage of scripture that is. In this passage, Jesus gives to us a beautiful picture of what a life based on love really, truly looks like. I know what many of you are thinking. Preacher, that's impossible. We can't live like that. It demands way too much of us. Who can love their enemies? Who can do good to those who hate them? Who can pray for those who mistreat them? And I mean, besides Jesus, He certainly did teach each of us those things. But can we do it? Can we love like Jesus loved? I stand here before you this morning and I say, I believe that we can. I believe we can. Maybe not perfectly. After all, we're not Jesus. But we can do better than what we're doing. We live in a fear-based world of anger, hate, vengeance. And how do we find our way out? I know this may sound a little simplistic, but I believe it's also true. Our only hope is the love of Jesus Christ. You see, fear and hate and not forgiving lead to retaliation, to revenge, to isolation, and even war, I guess, like Russia and Ukraine and all the rest of the world together. They are all one-way streets that lead to spiritual and sometimes actual death. Choosing love over hate frees us from our ego, from our fear, from our pride. It frees us to be a source for life instead of death. You know the situation in our world today. Do you really see any other hope for the world than that the love of Christ will be revealed to everybody? Madeleine Engel wrote this. She said, love isn't how you feel, it's what you do. We used to say it this way, you gotta walk the talk. Loving our enemies, doing good to those who hate us, praying for those who speak evil of us, forgiving those who mistreat us from the downward spiral of hate. Ephesians 2:4 reads like this. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Get rid of it all. Not some of it, okay? Get rid of it all. Don't hold on to a tiny crumb of bitterness or malice. It will grow into rage, anger, and even separation and death. There's better ways. Show your friends, your neighbors, your co-workers, your family, your loved ones, anyone you meet, the love of Jesus, and let love change the world. Let love change the world. And that's the hope of the world, folks, at least for me. Jesus knew not that everyone was going to listen to his teaching. The kind of love, generosity, and mercy that he expected from his followers, it doesn't make sense. It's risky. It's asking us to give up our rights, our pride, and our comfort. And yet it's the most powerful way possible for us to show the world that we belong to Christ. To love them until they ask us why. That way you will represent Christ and make a difference in the world. If you have any prayer requests, please pass them to the aisle and the usher will pick them up at this time. Our hymn of the day, let all mortal flesh keep silence. Please stand as we stand.
Thank you.
following people have been re-elected to their positions of leadership in our congregation, and I now ask them to come forward. Re-elected, Raul Calzadilla, Vanessa Perry, Charlene Grawl, Julia Rago. You have re-elected them for another 3-year term to be on your church council. They are joined on the church council by Miguel Guerrero, William Hill, come on up with your name is called, Lori Hill, Tom Johnson, Josie Lagarcha, Maria Marcy. We're going to go offline here for a while. Because he can't get his camera turned around fast enough.
What a lovely crew, huh?
In holy baptism, our Lord Jesus Christ liberated you from sin and death and made you members of his church. Through word and sacrament, you have been nurtured in faith. I ask you together, both you newly re-elected and those who are already on the council serving out their terms, I ask you to gather here and confess the faith of the church, the faith in which we are baptized. Just remember these words. St. Paul writes these words to us. There are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit gives them. There are different ways of serving, but the same Lord is served. There are different abilities to perform service, but the same God gives to everyone the ability for particular service. The Spirit's presence in some way in each person for the good of all. You have been elected to positions of leadership and trust. St. Mark's Lutheran Church. Here's what your job is. You are to see that the word and deeds of this household of faith reflect him in whose name we gather. You are to work together with other members to see that worship and work of Christ are done in this congregation, and that God's will is done in our community and in the whole world. You are to be diligent in your specific area of serving, that the one Lord who empowers you might be glorified. You are to be examples of faith active in love to help maintain the life and harmony of our congregation. On behalf of your sisters and brothers in Christ, I ask you, are you ready to accept and faithfully carry out the duties of the offices to which you have been elected and on which you serve? If so, say as a group, yes, by the help of God.
Yes, by the help of God.
People of God, I ask you now, will you support these, your elected leaders? Will you share in the mutual ministry that Christ has given to all who are baptized? If you please say, so love not so that they behind me can hear you. Yes, by the help of God.
Yes, by the help of God.
You got a team, bud. I now declare to all of you installed as officers and members of the Church Council of St. Mark's Lutheran Church. May God bless you with his Holy Spirit and may you prove faithful servants of Christ. May the prayer get seats. Maria, let me take you with the apostles.
Teach us to love our neighbors and enemies alike. Encourage your church to follow the leading of your love, especially when it is risky or difficult. Help us to show mercy just as you have first received mercy. God of grace,
pray.
Nurture fields that lie dormant, resting until it is born again to be Bless farmers and all who cultivate fields and urban gardens. Give favorable weather for planting. Bring forth from buried seed an abundant harvest, and guard against famine and disease. Guard with grace. Look upon our world with mercy, that we delight in an abundance of peace. Protect all those lives are all whose lives are marred by war and civil unrest. Release political prisoners and amplify voices that challenge us to seek forgiveness and pursue nonviolence. God of grace. Your people cry out for mercy. Console hearts that long for forgiveness. Mend broken relationships. Help bodies that suffer chronic pain or illness. Strengthen and deliver all those spirits, all whose spirits are troubled, especially Stephanie, Robin, Sharon, Dolly, Warner, Louise, Lois, Margarita, Juan Luis, Viviana, Callisto, Helmut, Gerardo, Darlene, Kevin, Andres, Don, Barry, Barbara, Anna Maria, Ed, Ozzy, Earl, and especially for Ryan Logan. God of grace. You bind us together into one family. Teach us to forgive one another, to resolve conflicts with humility and patience. Bless families in all shapes, of all shapes and sizes, and show love to those who are lonely or grieving. God of grace. We praise you for the saints you have inherited the fullness of your kingdom, as you have raised them to imperishable and eternal life. Sustain us in faith by the promise of resurrection. God of grace. Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all of our prayers to you in confidence and faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
you ask for my hands, my mouth, and my eyes to serve. I give only a small part of my life to you. Forgive me, renew me, and send me into the world with a changed heart, O God, that I might live to the glory of your holy name.
Folks, Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained pastor of the Church of Jesus Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare unto all of you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins. And I do so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Share that peace with each other. Don't move. Turn around and smile. Of course, I can't tell if you're smiling or not. Please be seated, and please present at this time your tithes, your gifts, and your offerings.
Thank you.
we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hope the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should give you thanks and praise, and with all the angels and saints, we sing your unending hymn. Saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Let us pray as our Lord has taught us to pray. Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Folks, the body of Christ given for you. Blood of Christ, it is shed for you. Please take out your. This is the body of Christ. It is given for you. Blood of Christ, it is shed for you. Give you peace.
Amen. Amen.